the Boko Haram were creating all kinds of violence way to the north. And they displaced and they killed many, many people. And I understand that you helped 300,000 refugees find a place or be taken care of for a while. And what most people don't know is that there is a school in northern Nigeria called the Chibok School for girls. And the Boko Haram captured several hundred of those young girls and took them into the jungle. And but some of them escaped. And you provided a place for them in your university in Nigeria to have them tutored and to have them get an education. And now, as president of Dickinson College here, I understand that some of those very girls or new girls have found their way to you. So I'm so energized and eager to hear what you have to say to us. Let's welcome Margee.
So Rwanda is near and dear to my heart. I just flew back. I was invited to speak at the 25th commemoration last Saturday, so if I'm slurring my words or not finishing my sentences, there's still a little bit of jet lag there, but it's a privilege to see how far this country has come. But before we look at the progress, which is sort of where my heart is, you have to understand where it came from. And it's a difficult story, because there are no good guys in this one. The US, the French, the UN, and unfortunately the Catholic Church, all implicated in what happened. And this was not a story of tribes killing each other. They're not different tribes. It's a much broader story. You have to understand the colonial structure here. So I will try to spend maximum of 30 minutes going through history, and then maybe 10 on progress, and then I'm happy to answer questions you might have. So let's begin. On April 7th, 1994, state-organized genocide began in Rwanda. Important words there. Genocide is never spontaneous. A plane crashing in Kigali is not the beginning of a genocide. It was state-organized. When it was over 100 days later, a million, you'll see figures 800,000, that's wrong. I've seen most of the graves. It's 1 million Tutsi and moderate Hutu. These are ethnic groups. These are not tribes. These are not different races. Children, men, and women had been slaughtered. Here's the New York Times. The genocide was a product of centuries-old intractable divisions between Hutu and Tutsi tribes. What's wrong with that sentence? They're not tribes, and there's no history of 100 years of conflict. So our knowledge of these societies is truly not very deep. So very quickly, why did it happen? Colonial powers, culture, the media, churches, and ideology. Why didn't anybody intervene? What happened to our international community? The US, the UN, the French, and the churches. Very briefly, I'll talk about the ICTR, the International Criminal Tribunal in Arusha, Gachacha, which is the world's greatest experience in post-genocide conflict resolution, and then the progress in the last 25 years. So it was 25 years ago, April 7th, and I said to Bonaventure, okay, I mean, we're best friends now, what happened? He said, yeah, I heard the plane crash. And the barricades went up 10 minutes after. Kigali is a small town. From anywhere within the city, you would have heard that. So let's see what happened. These 10 stages are very important. Greg Stanton, a scholar of genocide, has documented with every genocide that we know of, these are 10 stages that are replicated. They're important because we're not in a good place right now in the US, folks. And would never say, we're near conflict, but we are in some stages that give me pause. First, people were classified, Tutsi and Hutu. Tutsi and Hutu had intermarried, have the same language, have the same culture. So very deliberately, you're Tutsi, you're Hutu. Well, might not matter, but the Belgians, who were the colonial power for a while, said, well, you have to know who people are, so you have to have an identity card. Why an identity card? For taxes. On that identity card said whether you were a Hutu or a Tutsi. So when those roadblocks went up and people came up, they knew who was Tutsi and who was Hutu. So the second is a symbol, identity cards. Discrimination begins, quotas and laws against the group you're after. Dehumanization, you cannot kill your brother, your sister, your mother, your father, unless they have been dehumanized in every genocide, whether we're talking about the Holocaust, whether we're talking about the genocide against the Tutsi. So the dehumanization begins. There has to be an organization to carry it out. In Rwanda, it was the militias, the Interahamwe. Polarization begins, laws forbidding marriage or work for the government. And then you have to have the resources. You have to prepare for the final solution. Stage seven, 500,000 machetes. China to Rwanda in January 1994. More came in through France. Persecution and killings and the extermination. And unfortunately, stage 10 is always part of it. There's always denial, as there was after the Holocaust. There is in Rwanda, the RPF, the Rwandan Patriotic Front, the very brave soldiers, women and men, about a third women, who stopped it. There's all sorts of craziness out there. They started it. They created it. So these 10 stages have been replicated. Important to keep in mind as I run quickly through this. So how was Rwanda ruled? Before colonization, it was a feudal kingdom with Tutsi chiefs. Quote, commonplace. If you remember your history in 1885 when the Conference of Berlin, Rwanda was, quote, given to the Germans. But under the Treaty of Versailles in 1923, Rwanda was designated a protectorate of the League of Nations governed by Belgium. The Tutsi kings ruled indirectly for the Belgians. So if you had to rank order colonial powers, how were the Belgians? Terrible. Look at the Congo. Look at what they did in the Congo. So probably the most brutal colonial powers. And they ruled indirectly. And so people began to think the Tutsis represented the Belgians in some way. This is President Kagame speaking at the commemoration. All genocides begin with an ideology, a system of ideas that says this group of people here, they are less human. They deserve to be exterminated. The most devastating legacy of European control of Rwanda was the transformation of social distinctions into so-called races. We were classified and dissected, and whatever differences existed were magnified according to a framework invented elsewhere. The purpose was neither scientific nor benign, but ideological, to justify colonial claims to rule over and, quote, civilize supposedly lesser people. We are not. This ideology was already in place in the 19th century and was then entrenched by the French missionaries who settled here. Rwanda's 2,000 years of history were reduced to a series of caricatures based on Bible passages and on myths told to explorers. Totally accurate. So what was this ideology? What was this hypothesis, the Hamitic hypothesis? European racial theorists developed a notion out of thin air that Tutsis were a superior race, intellectually gifted, born to rule. John Speke, the first European to explore the Nile, published The Theory of Conquest of Inferior by Superior Races. The Tutsis were a Caucasoid tribe of Ethiopian origin descended from King David, the sons of Ham. We can see the Caucasian skulls and beautiful Greek profiles side by side with Semitic and even Jewish features. Over time, the Tutsis were taller than the Hutus, tall and thin, and looked a little more like us, so they had to be superior. The Hutus were peasants. The Tutsis differ absolutely by the beauty of their features and their light color, from the Mantu agriculturalists of an inferior type. The Tutsis were designated as the Hamites by the missionaries. Racism began. Remember, Hutu and Tutsi had intermarried, had the same language and culture. So it was a physical appearance that led to this division. So these myths conditioned the views and the actions of the colonists and had a big influence on the Rwandans. Maybe nothing would have happened, but you combine this with the introduction of those identity cards in 1933 and 34, because your identity then, that's who you are. You're a Tutsi. You've got your card to tell you who you are. So in the period of decolonization in the late 50s, in 58, 59, the killings began with impunity. Over 30,000 Tutsis were killed as political power began to shift to the Hutus as the Belgian pulled out. More killings in 63, 66, 67. Impunity. 100,000 Tutsis flee to Uganda and Congo. And the first regime, post-colonial, the Kayibanda regime, imprisoned or killed most Tutsi power holders. The Habarimana regime is the genocidal regime from 73 to 94, and they came up with their own ideology, Hutu power, based entirely on discrimination. So here's the Hutu power ideology that led to the genocide. Rwanda belongs to the Hutu, who were always its true inhabitants. They were brutally subjugated for centuries by the foreign masses. Foreign masses weren't the Belgians. They weren't the Germans, because the Tutsis had now been associated with the colonial powers. The Hutu represent the majority of the people, and they are the sole defense against the Tutsis' evil attempt to enslave us again. This racist ideology was supported by the missionaries, the media, and the church. All the major institutions in the country. So as I said, those identity cards were critically important. The refugees who are out of the country in Uganda, Congo, Europe, even in the US, wanted to come home. But they were told, there's no more room. We don't want you home. And then the Hutu ideology begins on RTLM, which is radio, television, no calling. So this begins to be broadcast in 93. This is the hardest one for me, raised as a Catholic. The Hutu Ten Commandments, folks. Published in Kangura, that would be Newsweek in the United States, right? It laid down a catechism for dealing with the Tutsi. The Tenth Commandment was any contact with the Tutsi was an act of treason, and it was the duty of every Hutu to spread widely this ideology and exterminate the Inyenzi. Inyenzi are cockroaches. Anybody study the Holocaust? Same thing. Vermin, cockroaches. It was hard to believe this. As I said, I've been working in Rwanda since 96 now. But when I saw it, Rwanda has the original. Here's the front page of Kangura, and there's the Ten Commandments. And it's chilling to see this in person. I'll show you in a minute who's on the back page of that particular issue of Kangura. So that was the churches. They're saying, it's an act of treason to work with the Tutsis, and it gets worse. The Tenth Commandment, exterminate those Inyenzi. Media, the media always plays a role in violence, in genocide. The hate radio was the major one. It began broadcasting in 93. It coincided because the government bought a bunch of cheap radios and passed them out. And this particular broadcast was designed to appeal to the illiterate, the unemployed, the thugs, and the street militia. The dehumanization has begun. It was broadcast mainly in Kinna, Rwanda, the local language. The planning began for all of this, unfortunately developed by a history professor out of Rotary, University of Rwanda. And the hate messages began in October of 1993. And as I sat in Arusha listening to those trials, I heard what was on that radio station. Hate is the only word. In November of 1993, and one of you reminded me that the U.S. ambassador at the time lived next door to the Prime Minister, Agatha, and she was one of the first killed during the genocide. So April 3rd, there are many Rwandans, Tutsis, trying to come back into the country. There's a great deal of fighting going on. President Habarimana signs a peace agreement in Arusha with the RPF, the Rwandan Patriotic Front, saying, I will share power under intense pressure from neighbors and the international donor community, including the US. And as you may have read, if you've seen any movies or anything on his flight back into Kigali, the plane was shot down. President Kagame has been accused of shooting it down, but it looks very much like it was someone within his government because he had signed this peace agreement. And as I said, the genocide began within 30 minutes. Roadblocks are up. You come up to a roadblock, show us your ID card. If you're Hutu, you go on. If you're Tutsi, you're killed. 1 million dead in 100 days. The most brutal genocide our time as a species. The dead of Rwanda accumulated at nearly three times the rate of the Jewish dead during the Holocaust. It was the most efficient mass killing since the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The first book out was by a friend, Phil Gorovich, who's a journalist. Interesting title, right? We wish to inform you that tomorrow we will be killed with our families. Where in the world did that title come from? Anybody know? So Phil was in Kigali not long after the genocide, and he walked into the church, a church. 11% of the killings occurred in churches. And he found a note on the floor, and he picked it up. And the Rwandans are very polite people. And somebody had written to his pastor, we wish to inform you, pastor, that tomorrow we will be killed with our families. And of course, no one knew. Tough story, as I said. So why not? Why didn't any of us do anything? Because we could have stopped this, as we could be stopping Myanmar right now. So UN commanders in Kigali had begged for months for assistance. They knew what was coming. General Dallaire, who's become a close friend, he sent a fax to the UN. He said, I know what's coming. We have found the weapons. We have found the lists of people. Who was chief of peacekeeping? Kofi Annan, who went on to be Secretary General of the UN. He said, no, you can't do anything. Your mandate, that's beyond the mandate that you have as UN troops there. In the midst of us, the Secretary General, in the midst of it, April, May, June, it ended July 4th on our Independence Day. In the middle of it, the Secretary General said, we must recognize that we have failed. Well, we were still failing at that moment and have acquiesced in the continued loss of life. Our readiness and capacity have been demonstrated to be inadequate at best and deplorable at worst. And he was right. There was no collective political will to respond to this little country in East Africa. Why didn't the churches intervene? Churches are the moral voices of our society, and Rwanda has always been a very religious place. As you can see, 90% Christian, 63% Catholic, 20% Protestant, and so on. Church leaders did more than remain silent, unfortunately. And I think my next book, if I can ever get up the courage, will be How Did Thou Shalt Not Kill Become Thou Shalt Kill? Because more people were killed in church buildings than anywhere else. And the question, of course, is, were the churches complicit? Well, why? How in the world did this happen, right? The missionaries like the Germans and the Belgians had bought into this. Rwanda was a country of two different human groups. And some have described it as a Hutu church and a Hutu state was the declared goal. The deep hatred of the Tutsis was understood to be in accord with sincere love of the church. And there were massive human rights violations leading up to the genocide. Tutsis sought refuges in the churches. I asked Bonaventure, what in the world did you do when that plane crashed? He said, I got my family. We got in two cars, because we hoped one car would make it. And we came up to the roundabout, and he said the killers were drunk. That's how they did it. Alcohol was deeply involved in this. And they're at the roundabout. And he said they were distracted. So he got through, both cars got through, and they went to a Saint-Famille church, which is right in downtown Kigali, and they hid there. And they certainly were looking for him because they knew exactly who he was and that he had just come back from the United States. So his wife and his immediate family survived in the church. The rest of his family did not. But here's a church, Naimata, which I visited not long after the genocide. My kin in Rwanda is not very good, but it basically says there will be revisionists who will say this did not happen, that there were not killings in the churches, so we're leaving it the way we found it. And that's what it looks like inside. So, several nuns have been convicted of genocide. The Seventh-day Adventist was convicted in the International Court of Justice. And as I said, 11% of the victims killed in the churches. So the religious folks, there were some who did protect Tutsis, mainly the Muslims. There's about 2% of the population was Muslim at the time, and there are Muslims who hit the Tutsis. How about the US? Powerful warnings of what were coming. The CIA, there was a report in 1993 that 500,000 people could die. At my last job before I went overseas, I was a dean and associate provost in California, and our general counsel had been the general counsel in the CIA. And I said one day, Elizabeth, why didn't you guys do anything? And her words were chilling. She said, Margee, if you ever could know how many reports like that we get, she said, we didn't know what was going to happen. Well, we'll see. If you remember that time, 1994, what was that movie, Black Hawk Down or something? We had just lost soldiers in Somalia, dragged through the streets of Mogadishu in body bags. So there was not a lot of desire to go into another, quote, small African state. In fact, the State Department said we're reluctant to intervene in another African nation where American interests, quote, were non-existent. Even when it became clear what was unfolding, President Clinton told the UN it had to learn when to say no. We actually know we went farther than that. Then Secretary of State Madeleine Albright blocked the UN from intervening. Not a good story of American power. At the height of the killing, State Department spokesman was a woman, were instructed not to use the word genocide. There's a very famous interview, and understand what's unfolding. And this woman is asked, is a genocide occurring in Rwanda? And she kept saying, acts of genocide are occurring. Acts of, but she would not say it was genocide. Why? Because we had signed the genocide convention, which required us to intervene if the genocide was unfolding. Sorry about this. That's right. At the height of the genocide in April, we opened the new Holocaust Museum, and President Clinton said it serves as a constant reminder that racism, anti-Semitism, and all forms of hatred are ever-present dangers. Indifference to hatred makes us complicit in some way. He said, I do not appreciate the scale of the killings. The NSA archives that have just been opened make it very clear that the Clinton administration was very aware of what was unfolding, getting daily reports on the killing. In fact, I interviewed once a guy from the Pentagon who was monitoring RTLM, the hate radio, which we could have turned off. And I said, why didn't we just shut that thing down? And he said, well, we were told it was a free speech issue. So I'm hard on everybody, but I have to say the French were the worst in this, and they're just beginning to admit what they did. France was very closely aligned with the regime of President Habyarimana, which carried out the genocide. Mitterrand, socialist, right? His government armed and trained the army and the militias. There's strong evidence that France continued to arm the regime during the genocide. Operation Turquoise, they flew in French troops, and they let the genocidaires go into that part of the country, and they flew them out to France. The archives have just been opened, and I think we'll learn a lot about French. In fact, if I can get this to work, sorry, I think it's the battery. There we go. Remember I said the kangaroo with the Ten Commandments? This was the back page. It says, Mitterrand, a good friend of Rwanda. The media was deeply involved. The survivor said, I listened to the RTLM because if you were mentioned on the airways, you were soon to be carted off in a short time. The dehumanization piece, Tutsi were described as vermin, snakes, dogs, kill them or they will kill us. Exterminate the Ensign, the cockroach. I actually sat through the trials. They were called the media trials at the ICTR in Arusha. The first time the editors were sentenced to 35 to life, and the Kangura editor sentenced to life. Am I doing well? There we go. No, we missed one. So how did this thing end? Well, it was Rwanda's. It was then Major Paul Kagame came in from Rwanda with his troops and ladies. I've met many of the women who fought. It's an interesting aside. Rwanda has more women in parliament than any country in the world. I don't know any other president who runs around the world talking about gender equity. And I once asked him, women fought right next to me. It was my women troops who helped stop this genocide. At the time in 1994, the participants fled to Eastern Congo. I'm sure you read or, you know, if you follow this, there have been all sorts of problems in Eastern Congo because some of those folks are still there. And for a while, they were rearming in the Congo. So then what? So the UN decided, all right, well, it's time to intervene. And they took over the trials of the organizers of the genocide, and that was the ICTR, the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. There have been others in Yugoslavia and Sierra Leone and so on. I'm pretty critical of this. It was about $5 billion and 93 cases were held. I'll tell you in a minute what happened in Rwanda. But there was a very important sexual precedent set. For the first time, sexual violence is considered a war crime. One of the hardest parts of this story is that Hutu prisoners were let out of prison during this if they were HIV positive, and they were told to go rape Tutsi women so they would be exterminated. It was a very, very difficult thing to learn about, but it happened, and many of those women are still alive, but now at least we have international precedent. So very quickly now, let me tell you how Rwanda has rebuilt to become the shining star in East Africa. Yes?
Could you please speak directly into the microphone, just position it directly at you?
Okay, better?
Well, toward you. Yeah, like straight into it. It's a omnidirectional.
So here's what Rwanda looks like in the country after. Before the genocide, 958 judges, afterwards 244. 12 prosecutors left, 137 support staff. How do you try? A million people were involved in genocide. The UN wasn't going to do it. They went in and got the masterminds. The government estimated it would take 200 years to complete the trial if they went through the conventional courts. So Rwanda went back, and this is the beginning of what are called homegrown initiatives. Traditional practices that were used not for anything of the scope and scale of genocide, but that people could relate to. Gachacha means trial in the hills, and it was used in colonial period and leading up to the genocide to try smaller crimes, you know, a cow that's been killed and, you know, a hut that's been ruined. And these brilliant people who took over the country and have been ruling it said, let's try Gachacha. Let's elect people in the country who were not involved in the genocide and train them to be judges. 260,000 people were elected. One of my colleagues who writes on this, a Stanford lawyer, said it's the largest experiment in public justice in modern history. So one summer, I was in Kigali and Bonaventure called and he said, I hear you're here. Will you go with me to my family's Gachacha trial? And most foreigners were not invited, were not allowed. And I thought, I need to do this with him. So this is someone signing in. The trials, if people confessed, the government had the evidence of who was being tried. If people confessed, they got a reduced sentence. So the training was from April to May on legal principles. It lasted for 10 years. Just signal me if you're not getting me in the back, okay? The Gachacha courts tried 1,958,000 cases, a million people. Convicting 86% and acquitting 14. It was the most comprehensive post-conflict justice program attempted in the world. It was extraordinary to watch it in action. So once a week, the Gachacha trials were held in every part of the country, and people from the community came to watch and often to support the prosecution. Those were the judges. Those judges were amazing. It was a 9-hour day. The trial was in the morning, and they spent the afternoon writing by hand the decision. this man I sat on a bench with, he was the mayor of the town. He killed 30 children. And I have to tell you, it was pretty weird to sit on that bench and wonder and kill Bonaventure's family. He was the murderer of Bonaventure's family. And he was unrepentant and did not confess. So he was sent back to jail for 30 more years. Right after the genocide, Rwanda gave up the death penalty. They said, we had enough killing in this country. But as we left the trial, Bonaventure said, let's just follow the car back. I want to make sure he goes back to prison. And I said to him, I mean, you know, we heard the entire story of what happened to his family, to his mom. And I said, how are you? And he said, I feel free now. Justice has been done. So there are people in the West who criticize the Gachacha trials and say, people didn't have a lawyer. Well, who was going to pay for the lawyer? The donor community wasn't going to pay for lawyers for a million people. And this was not just justice. It was the beginning of tying together a country again. Because unlike the Holocaust, the Jews were gone. They were dead, or they were in other countries. Not in Rwanda. The murderers are living on the same hills as the people whose families they killed. So it's a very different process. How do you find reconciliation? And Rwanda's doing remarkably in this area. So now, where are they? It's extraordinary to think in 25 years, life expectancy has doubled, a million people pulled out of poverty, 95% of that population has health insurance, better than the US, very rapid declines. I know there's a lot of doctors in the room, and infant and child mortality and maternal mortality that were among the highest in the world, and And as I said, more women in parliament than any country in the world, so public policy is beginning to look very different. Not surprising. Food security has improved, and as I said, gender equity, 66% of the parliamentarians are women. Rwanda is the only country in East Africa that made the Millennium Goals. Do you guys know the Millennium, the UN Millennium Goals in primary education? So extraordinary progress. Here's a little bit on GDP per capita. I'll bring it up to date in a minute. Here's life expectancy. Of course, it was in the low 40s in the 60s. You see the dip in 94 when a million people were killed, and it's in 2018, the last year we have data, it's a little over 70 years. You don't live longer if you don't have access to health care, food, housing. It's a really important variable. It's an important indicator because of what it tells us. Infant and under five mortality rates, very high in the 2000s, and now infant mortality is down to 32 per thousand, and child mortality, which is the number of deaths per 1,000 under five, down to 50. So rapid improvements in healthcare. It's pretty extraordinary to watch this happen. Maternal mortality, massive declines, and here's why. Percentage of deliveries assisted by skilled workers. So really, really good work in healthcare. GDP per capita, Rwanda is still a poor country, right? $2,080 in 2017, but it has doubled, it has actually tripled since 2000. So rapid progress in economic growth. What are they doing? Starbucks recently certified Rwandan coffee as their best specialty coffee. I can definitely tell you it is, since I'm sort of a coffee addict. But they're doing other things too that are important in terms of exports. So how did it happen, just very quickly? Well, progress doesn't happen without a vision. Right after the genocide, the new leaders got together and they said, where do we want to be by 2020? And this is what they said. Vision 2020 expresses the aim of attaining the per capita income of a middle-income country in an equitable way, the aspiration to become a modern, strong, and unified nation. There are people in the international community who laughed at this and said, there's no way they're going to be a middle-income country. It's impossible. Now, they haven't made it yet. But these are very aspirational folks, and they have very high dreams for their country. This is important. At the core of our process will be what constitutes Rwanda's principal asset. There are not a lot of natural resources in Rwanda. They have found natural gas in Lake Kivu, but their leaders were very visionary to say, it's our people. That's the source of our strength, and we hope to be a knowledge-based economy. We encourage science and technology. ICT in most of the world, it's not IT, it's ICT, information and communication technologies. It's extraordinary. Rwanda is using drones to develop, to deliver medicine to the poorest parts of the country. The country's wired for IT, so the one laptop per child program is being used there. So really visionary people. Here's just some of the other homegrown solutions. Umuganda, they once a month, every community has to stop work. It's a Saturday, there's no cars on the road, and you clean up your neighborhood. And you make sure there's no standing water, so there's no malaria. It's really extraordinary. One day I drove by and the president was out in the front, cleaning the front of his house. So everybody does it. Abunzi is mediation. Garinki, a response to childhood malnutrition, cows for families. I'm gonna spend just 2 minutes on Ubudehi and Inahigo, because I think this is a big part of why Rwanda's come back, and I think every country in the world could adopt this. So Ubudehi is a traditional, another one of these traditional homegrown solutions. You can see where it came from. But what it is now is when a community comes together, these are still very poor folks, and the poor say, this is what we need for our lives to be better. We need this income, we need education. So they're deeply involved in designing and saying what they need. So it's a participatory process of budgeting and planning, where citizens say, this is how much money we need, and this is how we're going to use it. Well, so maybe that's not so revolutionary. That's the social mapping that's going to do it. But this is performance-based government in Rwanda. Throughout the whole society. It started with the mayors. I was in the country one summer, and the Ministry of Ed said, come with me to hear these presentations. I said,
mayors were presenting like this, right? And there was a red light, a yellow light, and a green light. And the mayors presented, and there was somebody standing there. And if they weren't following the plan, if they weren't performing, if they weren't doing what the citizens had said they wanted, red light. If you were sort of doing well, you could get two yellow lights. But after two yellow lights or one red, you're out. You're a green light, good job. It's extraordinary, right? Now it's throughout the country. Everyone signs in the HECO, which is a contract saying, this is what I commit to you to accomplish. Wouldn't that be great if we had it in the US?
Amen.
Let's do it. So that's what it looks like. So I had to go see this, so I went out and saw the mayors doing it. And this is what it says in English. This was for the mayors. I, in the name of the population I represent, I pledge to actually achieve the objectives that are in this contract. It's a great idea. I think it's a big part of why Rwanda is succeeding. They're all different. That's what the MEGO looks like. The federal government has to put in a certain amount of money. The local people have to put it in. It's monitored constantly so you can actually see if things are working. I think it's an accountability mechanism. It's a way to engage the poor. You know, we do stuff in the donor community. We do stuff to the poor and for the poor. But do we do things with them? And that's what this process does. I think it is leading to a new model for state planning. So 25 years after the genocide, Rwanda is making remarkable progress. It's a peaceful place. You can walk those streets any time of the day or night and not worry. In education, in gender, economic growth, and poverty reduction, justice, governance, local participation, healthcare, and ICT, of course problems remain. In agriculture, the population is probably growing too rapidly, but with infant and child mortality coming down, that's the first thing that has to happen before fertility declines, so it probably will. Poverty and income distribution, but transformational leadership is in place. So, in my view, Rwanda is a country with vision, with honest, capable, and transformational leaders, focused on the future, developing new models, dealing with its history, and empowering hope. Thank you for your time. Too poor to make a Hollywood movie, but there are books out on it. I'd be happy to share.